Every year, our top Gaelic footballers commit themselves to work and to train in search of a dream. That dream is to win the All-Ireland football title and the Sam Maguire Cup, the most famous trophy in Irish sport. 1992 was a year of upsets, great incident, and many talking points. It was a season that will live long in the memory. A season once more in search of Sam.
Dias Mariv agus Falte Roiv. A special welcome to those of you from abroad who are new to Gaelic games. The Gaelic Athletic Association in Ireland organises two major field games, hurling and Gaelic football. And in this video, we're going to concentrate on Gaelic football. For the average football player in Ireland, the season commences on the small fields of the country playing for the local club. Very few players ever make it to the county team, and only the really select ones make it to Croke Park on the third Sunday in September for the winning of the Sam Maguire Trophy. We know you will enjoy the skill and tenacity and sportsmanship displayed by the players in those games, that you will marvel at the crowds and the colour and the excitement. Bíleann agus buint thatnamh as na tléithe.
And a free to Tyrone. Alongside me today in the box, the Down manager, Peter McGrath. Peter, could be quite a tussle today.
Yes, I think we're...
As always, the season began in earnest with the concluding stages of the National League. In the quarter-finals at Breffni Park, Tyrone beat Roscommon, but only after a bright start by the Connacht side.
Andy Layden, the ball goes straight through, and McManus with the punch! What a lightning start by Roscommon! They split the entire Tyrone defence. He got the touch, the ball in the back of the net. Devlin had it, lost it, recovered. Gives the ball to Donnelly. The Queen's Sigerson player down towards O'Hagan. He's in behind the defence. There must be a chance here for Tyrone into McCabe. His first effort is in the net. Well, the two All-Stars combined, and they combined with great effect.
In the second quarter-final, few would have predicted Donegal and Dublin as the future All-Ireland pairing. It was a game of four goals and a never-to-be-forgotten finish by Dublin.
Really beginning to liven up here for the second quarter-final down towards Boyle, who will come back to it. Goes back to McMullen, a real chance for Donegal. Goal! What a goal! Ball comes back into Farrell, chance for Dublin perhaps to get a score just before the break. Neat play by the centre man, gives it into Foran. Foran goes for the shot, good block, still gets it. The ball hits the post, goes back, it's in the net. Paul Curran gets the ball 10 yards, takes it quickly in towards Murphy. Could be danger, he gets it. Brilliant play. A goal, certainly, yes, for Dublin. A chance here, certainly. Farrell, he thought about leaving it. Goes to the equaliser, the ball blocked. Murphy collects it. Straight through again, it's through a goal. Oh, unbelievable stuff. Towards Toha once more.
In the semi-final, Derry were always in control against Meath, although they had to withstand a late rally.
Toholl again, down towards Brolly. Can he get in front? Indeed, he gets the touch. Now this man's got pace, he's got confidence, and he can finish. He still goes. Brolly goes on, gets the shot in. That's a marvellous score by the young man. Cusker again out towards Toholl. Coyle, as Meath begin to come into this game, really, for so long, Derry have outplayed them. They still only lead now by 3 points. McGilligan once again down towards Brolly. Ferguson loses it. Brolly again in the action. Great work by Brolly. Destate in front of the goals. He'll go for the point, surely. Excellent, Joe Brolly. Great score. Once again, he'll hoist it in towards Stafford. Who'll it break to? Breaks to Riley. He goes through and he was held. He reacts to the challenge from Quinn. Goes for the shot. The ball ends up in the back of the net. And the referee, in fact, gives it. He takes it quickly into O'Rourke. And O'Rourke still goes. Goes for the shot. He strikes it over the bar. There's a point between the sides.
Derry then holding on by a point, and that's the way it turned out in the second game. This time Tyrone coming out in front of Dublin.
As Dublin come in search of a score just before the half-time break. Kilpatrick out in front, doesn't get it, gives it in to Vinnie Murphy. Murphy right through the Tyrone defence. McConnell comes out, he tries for the shot, he gets it, and the ball tipped in. It's in the back of the net. Referee didn't see the push. Donaghy goes on as Tyrone come again in search of the equaliser. Donaghy this time puts it into O'Leary and puts it over. And once again, it's a mighty one deep in towards the danger zone. Donaghy goes up, he got the touch, comes to O'Hagan. O'Hagan puts it through to... Oh, well played, Jack Sheedy. And once more, the vital touch doesn't go for Tyrone. And that was a high challenge on Donaghy. Referee says, play away. Gives it back to McLeanan. Looks for the long-range score. And he gets it.
I suppose, as expected, Dermot McNichol is...
The National League final gave us an indication of how the All-Ireland series would go, with Ulster to the fore. In the Royal Liver decider in May, we had the first All-Ulster final since 1983. Tyrone on top for most of the game, but what a finish by Derry. We join it in the second half.
Takes it up in the middle of the field. There was a hefty challenge by Downey. Referee says play away. Carr on the break. Looks for support, still goes himself. Carr will attempt to finish this one. And in many ways, an unpredictable player. On his day, he's sheer class. McGurk will use the breeze to loft this in towards Downey. Downey goes up, but Long got the touch. Downey picks up the pieces. The ball blocked. Comes to Brolly. He's had very little opportunities in this game. He got one there and he took it. Gives it near side to McGurk, just below us here in the Hogan stand. A neat ball in towards Downey. Downey out in front. Long got the touch, but it's picked up by Gormley. He's got McGill. He goes for the point. And Paul Donnelly, eager to get on with it, gives it across field to Noel Donnelly. Could have been dangerous. But Donnelly takes the challenge of Downey and gives it near side down towards McCaffrey. McCaffrey and Downey in the chase. McCaffrey holds it and keeps in play into McLeanan. This is more like it from Tyrone. He turns the defence, still goes. Ball goes across into Canavan. Shirley. Peter Canavan's goal separates the sides. 4 minutes to go on Croke Park, plus stoppage. Referee again spots an infringement. That'll be a free to Derry. And they might just hop this in around the house. Maybe looking for the goal. Yes, in it goes, in towards Downey. Up they go. He gets the flick. There must be a goal. Oh, what a save! Oh, that was the chance for Bateson. That was the chance of the goal. And Toole will take the 45-metre kick. Will he go for the point or drift it? And he drifts it in towards McConnell's goal. Up they go! The ball's in the back of the net. Oh, Toole raises his arms. What an amazing goal for Derry. Just as Tyrone seemed to have thwarted the danger, the ball drifted in and through the hands of the defence. A grandstand finish, yes. But Derry, they have possession. They will look about the winner. And if Tyrone lose this one there, they will obviously point to that disastrous effort in defence. The ball comes to Downey. Gives to Toole. Toole looks for the winner. Well, indeed, the lead. He gets it. There's the man who got the goal. He gets the point. The last minute of normal time. Unbelievable. And there, the frustrated face of a Tyrone supporter. He and indeed everybody from Tyrone will know that they had this National League title wrapped up. But Derry, a team who fought back from 4 points behind in the opening minutes of the first half, fight back again, and now quite incredibly lead by a point. And the referee still says there's time to play. Comes to Brolly out in front. Derry will hope for another score. They give it back to Heaney. He scored them from here before. He steps inside the challenge. Is there a point for Derry? He puts it in. Indeed there is. And the Derry men will celebrate. The National League title for 1992 is theirs.
In the Connacht Championship, most people expected that Roscommon would come through because of the fact that they ran me very close in the All-Ireland semi-final last year. But it didn't work out that way. In the first game, Leitrim disposed of London quite easily. And then one of the major clashes between Galway and Mayo ended in a draw. Galway had to come from quite far behind to get a replay on that day.
Voss Tierney driving it in towards Ray Dempsey. Knocked away. Comes to Liam McHale. Oh, what a magnificent goal! Liam McHale coming through like a tornado. Pat Comer hardly saw it. Voss Tierney who dropped it in. Ray Dempsey knocked it down. Liam McHale was coming through. And bang, right into the corner of the net. Ryan Kilkelly doing well. Anthony Finity. Ray Dempsey's gone inside. Two Mayo players. One of them is McHale. In front of the post and straight over the bar. And every time Liam McHale gets within scoring range, it looks very simple. So Anthony Finnerty, with 23 minutes gone in the second half, and with number 23 in his back, he puts it over the bar. So Mayo now lead by 111 to Galway's 7 points. His intended pass easily intercepted by Sean Glenn. Comes to Kevin Walsh. Long ball really is needed. Bit slow on the delivery, but it comes in, however. Great opportunity and a marvellous goal. A marvellous goal by Fergal O'Neill. It was a long time coming, but when it came, it was well worth the wait. So this match by no means over. So the pressure being exerted very much on Mayo at the moment. Breaks inside now. Can Galway get another goal here? Bursting through, Tommy Wilson, and eventually goes over the bar. Well, Galway are fighting just to survive in this Connacht Championship, and now they need the break. Brilliant fielding by Charlotte Fallon. He sends it over the bar. The sides are level in Tuam Stadium. Charlotte Fallon from Tuam on his own home pitch equalises this Connacht Championship match in dramatic fashion. That was a goal chance.
Mayo won the replay, quite surprisingly, as many people felt Galway would be a force to be reckoned with.
Gabriel Irwin advanced well, and Mayo can punish Galway on the counter-attack. Tony Morley on the run, getting into a point-scoring position. That's a good chance, that's a good point by Tony Morley. Alan Mulholland watching the break for Galway, but so too is Lee McHale, who is very influential in this game. Noel Durkin had Jareth Jennings to his right. Noel Durkin tries for the point and gets it, and Noel Durkin is really on song today. Dempsey wins it for Mayo, having such a good game, Raymond Dempsey, and trying for a point from a very, well, a very ambitious sort of position, but Raymond Dempsey is going so well that the point was always on.
This is Ollie Haven.
In the next game, Roscommon defeated Leitrim by 5 points.
They might well have won here in 1990, dominated the 1991 contest, and here they come in 92, looking for their opening score, and they get it, and it's put over by Liam Conlon.
Liam Conlon coming through, probably should have put it in the net, but at least a point.
It's Andy Leyland again, now teaming up for Vincent Glennon. This should be put over the bar by Vincent Glennon. Now Pory Kenny. Can he be a Leitrim match winner yet? Setting one up for Paul Kieran, 20 metres out on the tight angle. Liam Conlon going in, here's a scoring chance. Another great save by Gay Sheeran.
Liam Conlon gets through the tackle there of Joey Connaughton, who could have cut it out, but Gay Sheeran guesses right and goes to his right and makes a very valuable save. That's twice he's saved Roscommon this half.
Still persisting. Good sign of a good player. Barney Breen, another great save by Gay Sheeran.
Liam Conlon getting the better of Damien Donlan, comes in here, gives off a lovely pass to Barry Breen, but he should have probably gone around Gay Sheeran, tries to blast it. Gay Sheeran gets down very well.
That's played in, touch back brilliantly, and a goal chance for Paul Kieran.
And he was coming in there, I thought he should have played the ball back out the field because he had a Barney Breen there, but he fairly rifled him into the roof of the net. It had to be a good shot to beat Gay Sheeran with the sort of form that he's in today, but it really sets Leitrim up to win the match.
Leitrim lead by 4 points. 11 minutes into the second half. A long, long way to go as Tommy Graham's long kick hits the post, comes off, it's a goal! It's a fluke! But it counts! Tommy Graham, the goal scorer! There was an instant response! Derek Duggan touching it down for Tony McManus. Denied by Thomas Quinn, and I think it's crossed the line, or has it? Yes! Up towards Derek Duggan, the kind of ball he likes, played right into his hands. A chance to turn and take on defenders. A real scoring chance for Derek Duggan as he shows just a little bit too much of it to the backs. Still picks himself up and kicks a fine point.
Surprisingly, Sligo provided very stiff opposition for Mayo in their semi-final.
Down by Lee McHale to Raymond Dempsey. Good ball by Lee McHale. Noel Durkin is free here. He's surely put it in.
Eamon Malloy for Sligo, looking for full forward Fintan Feeney, Peter Ford covering, and driven through by Johnny Kenny. A great score
a first time pull by Johnny Kenny as that ball dropped.
Marnival Hearn and Shane Tully combined. Johnny Kenny knocked it down. Is there a score there for Sligo? Yes, there is, and a good score too.
Maher went highest for Mayo. Staunton was in support. Peter Ford was in support too from full back, and he'd love to get a point, Peter Ford, the Mayo captain.
The final thus produced a Mayo-Roscommon combination. But again, most people felt Roscommon, given the fact that they were going for three in a row, would prove too tough and too experienced for the Mayo team.
It has suited Derek Duggan, and he's got a point that stretches Roscommon's lead to two.
Just as Derek Duggan takes the big ones for Roscommon, Gareth Jennings has a very good drive of a dead ball with the wind, but that ball knocked through there and put into the net by Raymond Dempsey. Gareth Jennings was looking surely to score a point. He was probably disappointed that that ball dropped short, and as it did, Roscommon fullback Pat Dury got into all sorts of trouble, lost the ball, Dempsey put it into the net. Junior McManus has slipped inside looking for a high ball. Tony McManus has gone free too. Kevin Byrne challenging Tony McManus. Tony looking for the point. The class, the sheer class of Tony McManus. Good ball to Anthony Finnerty in front of the goal. Finnerty is looking for a goal here. Sheridan gets a block. It's gone over the bar. It might well have gone under, and the crossbar's come down. Kevin Staunton, the Mayo substitute, with a terrific drive by Kevin Staunton, and it's gone in over the bar. Seamus Killorn has played with great spirit throughout. Gives a good ball to Paul Early. He hasn't been in the game all that much, Paul Early. Looking for the point. That's a very sweet kick by Paul Early. That's a delightful point. That's much more like it by Roscommon. Kevin Staunton for Mayo. Anthony Finnerty, who's had a great match for Mayo, gives a good ball to Pádraig Grogan. There's a point there for Pádraig Grogan. That's a spectacular effort. Kevin Staunton is looking for a point, and he's got it, Kevin Staunton. And that's his third point from play, from long range, Kevin Staunton. Kevin Staunton, once again for Mayo. He'll remember this day. He has scored 3 points to TJ Kilgallen, who can round off a fine personal performance here. TJ Kilgallen, and a fine performance by Mayo too.
The Leinster Championship opened in a blaze because, again, we were given a shock result very early on. Meath, beaten All-Ireland finalists for the past 2 years, were up against Laois. And the match was played at Navan, a venue where Meath are virtually unbeatable. Laois come out winners by 2-11 to 1-11 after a very tough, hard game of football. I suppose that particular result gave other teams in Leinster great hope, particularly Dublin, who were to travel to Offaly in their first game, a game which Dublin won surprisingly well.
First attack in towards Vinnie Murphy. Vinnie Byrne going back there, that's booted in, a dramatic goal! Pádraig Doherty's very first touch.
I would think that this would be Dublin's policy anyway for the whole game, to pump the ball in and hope for the best with the conditions the way they are. It's a great start for Pádraig Doherty in his first championship game.
It's kicked in well. Vinnie Murphy reaches high. Charlie Redmond should be a second, but it is.
Well, the Dublin tactics are fairly straightforward. They're going to pump the ball in. Conditions are bad. Nobody's going to be catching. Charlie Redmond coming in on the break. And it's a great shot.
Murphy's first point of the second half, taking 10 minutes to produce. But again, they're attacking. And again, there's a chance of a goal here. And it's rattled in splendidly. Well, it's just what the game requires. And Vincent Claffey from Doon, the goal scorer. But the classy play has been provided by Dublin. If anything, revelling in the conditions. Fleet-footed footballers who certainly have shone. An injection of pace by Desi Farrell. Jersey pulled by Ken Keelahan. Free kick to Dublin. United, the one who's fouled, taking it himself across here to Porrick Doherty, another goal chance perhaps. Vinnie Murphy now opting to fist, and he's put it over the bar.
Meanwhile, Laois, the conquerors of Meath, were drawn against Louth. A game which took place in Croke Park in front of more than 30,000 people.
Belted forward again towards Leo Turley. From Wolves, Colin Maher. Just holding that ball up there, despite the attentions of Ken Rooney. Fed back to Michael Lawler. Lawler in the clear and a chance of an equalising score, and it's put over the bar to Tony Maher again. Nicely gathered by Joe Nolan, fed back to the influential midfielder, trying to complete and embellish that move with a score, and that's one of the best points of the match so far. Michael Dempsey belting it in from the sideline, kick comes down off the hands of Stephen Melia, and it goes to Michael Lawler, a goal chance, and it's there! For a loud side managed by Declan Smith, watching now as Seamus O'Hanlon got one of the best points of the first half. To fire in the ammunition for the inside forwards. Colm Kelly breaks it down, regathers himself. He's kicked another beauty. One-handed, held onto it there by Peter Fitzpatrick, despite the attentions of Michael Lawler. Rapid-fire football. Now again, pressing forward. Colm Kelly trying to feed it outside, taken by Martin Dempsey. Eamon Lacy just expecting a second or two too long, and that's Stephen White. The ball is kicked over the bar for the equaliser. Out to Ken Rooney. George Doyle watches it sail down. Beautifully played in by Redmond O'Neill. Onside to Cathal O'Hanlon as Louth tried to take the lead again. Emerson now back to Maher. Third time to be involved in the attacking movement. The point scoring chance availed of by Colin Maher. It's 12 points to 11. No longer are they level. The ball is kicked over the bar. John O'Connell, the point scorer. Fitzpatrick's kick towards Kevin O'Hanlon, held away, however. Still persisting there against Martin Dempsey. 4 minutes less than that to go. O'Hanlon trying to thread it across invitingly in there for Brady to hit onto, and he's put it over the bar. That's Donald Brady, the second half substitute. So a point between them once more, and Louth again hit the front. There was nobody on it.
Mick O'Dwyer's Kildare, who in the eyes of many people should have a relatively easy passage to the final, were playing Wicklow on the same day.
Now Seamus Dowling reading it well. Martin Lynch and Davy Dalton. Oh, that's a high one from Paul Allen, and dangerously into the face there of Davy Dalton.
Well, the Wicklow players are beginning to get a bit frustrated because they're being totally dominated all over the field. But
he sent him off. Well, he gave him the lecture, and that seemed to indicate that he was going to allow him to stay on. Nicely fetched. Beautifully taken by Niall Buckley. Then up towards Jarlett Gilroy. Ooh, a hefty collision, and the Wicklow man has come off second best as Declan Kerrigan advances, pounces, and scores magnificently! Sean McGovern, 45 metres out, and he simply wants to punish the passing errors being made by Wicklow. 45 metres out from the Kildare goal, again putting on the pressure. And it's Terry Allen seeking a way through, and he's gold. It comes in the 27th minute after Kildare had begun to go to sleep. Such was the margin of their lead.
Dublin had Wexford as their next opponents, and again they won convincingly.
Certainly the scoring hero for Dublin this afternoon. Charlie Redmond looking for Vinnie Murphy. It was a great ball by Charlie Redmond, and Vinnie Murphy puts it across the goal and into the net.
Kildare meanwhile had an unexpectedly tough game against Westmeath.
dropping it dangerously in. And shot in! A goal for Westmeath! Well, what a start! It's a Roundhead team. A total shock. So Brendan Penny's goal separating the sides now. And that's a rather strong boot by John Cooney. And remember, he's been booked earlier. And Paddy Russell is having a deep conversation with the man from Carlstown, Kinnegad, and he sent him off, and really he had no option because Cooney had been booked earlier. Tom Harris giving it to Glenn Ryan. Charlie Gilroy sending it across. This must be a goal. Oh yes, a brilliant goal by Johnny McDonald. Greg falls straight into the arms of Anthony Rainbow. Charlie Gilroy sending it in. Johnny McDonald is there, and the referee is giving a free, and in fact he's giving a penalty. This is crucial really for Westmeath. Charlie Gilroy low, and there it is in the back of the Westmeath net, where the Kildare people love to see it. Long ball in towards Larry Giles, gets a hand to it. A goal for Westmeath. And suddenly, O'Connor Park in Tullamore is alive once again with shouts for Westmeath. And here come Kildare. Tom Harris, Brian Fahey to his right. Still Tom Harris, a great run, met by Tom Darcy and dispossessed. And the referee has given a penalty yet again. Charlie Gilroy facing Dermot Ryan from the penalty spot for the second time this afternoon. Successful the first time, and successful the second time. Trying to finish now with a flourish. Good ball into Brian Fahey in space. Declan Kerrigan, there's a goal on here. And there it is. The best move of the match comes in the last minute, which is really the icing on the cake for the Lily Whites. And they can now book their tickets for July 26th and Croke Park for a Leinster final.
Dublin were now pitted against Louth in their semi-final. And certainly Louth were extremely well prepared for this game. In many ways they had nothing to lose. They were going in as very severe underdogs.
Giving it to Pat Gilroy, another goal scoring opportunity, and a great save by Niall O'Donnell. Colin Kelly just inside Dublin 45 metre line. Drops it gently over the bar, and despite Dublin's dominance, Louth are level at 3 points each. Here come the Dublin half-back line again. Keith Barr chasing after him. Pat Butterley. Charlie Redmond. That's a great point if it goes over. It does. Here come Loud now. Knocked inside to Stephen White. He's deadly from this range, and he's got a goal. The one opportunity that Stephen White gets, he sticks it home.
Sickening blow for Dublin considering the amount of possession they have had. Kevin O'Hanlon does very well to knock a ball down. Nick Deacon caught the wrong side of his man, and Stephen White keeps the ball low and under John O'Leary for a very good goal.
Nice interlinking football. Seamus O'Hanlon. Paul O'Hanlon. Across to Colin Kelly. A point from 45 metres out. Oh, wonderful score! Now all bets are off with Loud leading by 4 points. So who is going to play Kildare on July 26th? Ball inside to Stephen White. What a start this would be. And that's another point. So Charlie Redmond hits it sweetly. And hits it straight over the bar. That's a great point now for Dublin. Sided against giving a fisted pass. That goes to nobody in particular, but it works out for Seamus O'Hanlon. Nice play by the Loud midfielder. He's worked himself into a good scoring position, and that's a great point by Loud. And Seamus O'Hanlon, a real solo effort. Two Dublin players around Kelly. Outside, Donald Brady. Stephen White is at the edge of the square. This is John Osborne in a good position. And he's put it over the bar. At this moment in time, there's absolutely nobody inside the Dublin 45-metre line. Barton O'Leary, that is.
Mick Galvin, Jimmy Damon Heary. Great play by the left half back, and the sides are level again. Desi Farrell, rather, and he is the free as well. Out to Jack Sheedy. That's a great effort if it goes over. The umpire signals. Gathered by Desi Farrell. Vinnie Murphy, Mick Galvin coming out to gather it. It's Galvin that gets there first. This could be the insurance point for Dublin. It is. Keith Barr. And Mick Galvin gives outside to Jack Sheedy. And two quick points makes it an easy passage for Dublin.
The final then threw up Kildare against Dublin. And I suppose, as far as Kildare were concerned, this was to be their day of reckoning. But in the first half of that game, Dublin played what was perhaps the best football seen to date in the entire championship.
Familiar lines. Curran, Barr and Heary form a very formidable half-back line. While the half-forward line of Charlie Redmond, Jack Sheedy and Niall Guyden showed great potential in the semi-final. The Lily Whites make one positional switch from the semi-final. Captain Martin Lynch moves from full forward to corner forward with a possible plan to roam around Croke Park. Niall Buckley and Sean McGovern will be severely tested in midfield, while the forwards, particularly Jarlick Gilroy and Johnny McDonald, have looked threatening. And Dublin playing with that wind to their backs. And here comes Kildare. It's Brian Fahey from Leixlip going through, taking a shot, and it's over the bar. Anthony Rainbow, half getting there. Desi Farrell gets there. The only one of the Dublin under-21 side that lost the Leinster final to Kildare. Giving it inside to Paul Clark. Dangerously across, Vinnie Murphy. Taking a shot, and that's a great point by Vinnie Murphy. And referee Brian White telling Tommy, come on, let's get on with it. Much to the delight of the Kildare crowd.
Well, there's no prisoners being taken in this game, and Tommy Carr had done very well to take the ball off Martin Lynch and was fouled there, but the referee quite rightly told him to get out of it.
Here comes Keith Barr. Oh, what a magnificent goal! The half-back line of Dublin have now scored one goal and 2 points. Well, Keith Barr, an unstoppable shot to the back of Gerald Gannon's net. Hill 16 comes alive.
Well, we won't see a goal like that for a long time again. Great play by Charlie Redmond. Keith Barr coming through, 21 yards out. An absolutely unstoppable shot.
Mick Deegan is available to his left. Curran decides to aim at Vinnie Murphy. Desi Farrell. Going through and taking a point. Really, the Lily Whites need a goal to make any worthwhile challenge in the second half. Niall Buckley is a man available as Paul McLaughlin. Drives it in, long and true, and that is a great point by Paul McLaughlin. This is Martin Lynch and Tommy Carr. Lynch started behind Carr, but he got there in the end, and he takes a long range shot. Oh, a brilliant point by Lynch. This free for Charlie Redmond to put a little bit more breathing space between the Dubs and the Kildare people, and he puts it over the bar. Paul Curran. Dangerously in towards Vinnie Murphy. Davy Dalton comes to Charlie. Oh, and a brilliant save by Gerald Gannon. 29 minutes gone in the second half. Charlie Redmond with the 45. Oh, that's a sweet, great kick by Charlie Redmond. That puts plenty of breathing space between the Dubs and the Kildare lads. Giving it to Niall Buckley. Has to be really a goal here. Declan Kerrigan driving it in low. Oh dear, oh dear. Inches to the wrong side of the post.
The Munster Championship provided a number of quite surprising results. The big clash obviously was going to be the Kerry-Cork game. And most people felt that the winners of this particular game would emerge as provincial champions. And indeed, Cork went into the game as very, very hot favourites.
They formed such a powerful axis in the Kerry attack, lobbed in delightfully in here. And Cork have been in some trouble here. That's Cahalan wrestling, and the referee has awarded a penalty. John Kearns shaping up to a great goal by Maurice Fitzgerald. is a week for Paddy Hayes. He gets married on Saturday next to Valerie Cunningham, who is a sister of Ger Cunningham, the Cork hurling goalkeeper. But that's kicked inside and it's bounced over the bar. Out there for Stephen O'Brien. He sold the puck over there. It's Billy O'Shea coming forward. A menacing raid here by Kerry. Ambrose O'Donovan coming into the equation, 40 metres out, outside towards John Cronin. Cronin, who can hit it with the left, does so and opens up a three-point gap once again. That's Cronin's first point of the match. Comes out towards Ambrose O'Donovan. Loose play picked up by Danny Cullity. On towards Teddy McCarthy. Shea Fahey bursting forward, across towards John O'Driscoll. Out first time by Gleeson, not as far as Niall Cahalan. That's the point by Cahalan. That's Sean Burke performing manfully at right half back. Jack O'Shea now. A number of options available to him, holding up the ball. Parlade was moving on his right. Jack doesn't need the support. He kicks it truly over the bar. Into open space towards Billy O'Shea, who's been marked by Mick Snowden for the second half. Fleming coming purposefully forward again, knocking one forward to Parlade. Crisply hit with the left boot, and that's a delightful score by Parlade. And it's Liam Flaherty coming out from quarter back, held up there momentarily by Joe Cavanagh. Paul McGrath forcing the issue now, trying to carry the fight forward here for Cork, trying to impose their will on the Kerry team, who've been leading all the way. This is Tony Davis, weapon in advanced position, breaks down towards Teddy McCarthy, 13 metres out. And it's gone high and it's gone over, and there was a goal chance there for Teddy McCarthy. They've looked really good in Corky Cueve. That's Eamon Breen kicking from 40 metres out. That's a terrific score. 111 to 9 points. Kerry finishing strongly now. There are 11 minutes to go. Morris Fitzgerald with the second point from play. His tally, a goal and 7. This is Morris Fitzgerald for a Kerry side trying to tighten the screw. Holds it up quite deliberately, strikes one from way out, and he's put it over. Back to Tony Davis. 4 minutes to go. Cork needing a couple of goals. This is Barry Coffey. That's a foul and a penalty, or is it? It's a penalty, yes. Had to be. So Peter O'Leary, for the second time in the match, facing a penalty. The last was in the 9th minute of the second half. This is Shea Fahey this time. And they've missed the second one. An interesting statistic from this match is that Cork have had just 2 wides in the second half. Would you believe it? You'll have to. They were both from penalties. An amazing statistic. This is Billy O'Shea, and a Kerry goal! A second Kerry goal of the match, and that will have killed off the tie, absolutely.
Kerry then had to contend with Limerick in the next round, and Limerick proved to be very difficult opposition, but Kerry still won on a 114 to 111 scoreline. But on the other side of the draw, the team that would prove to be the dark horses, Clare, were emerging. They beat a fancy Tipperary team by 211 to 27, thus getting them into a final against Kerry. Most people would have given Clare very little chance, so the result was a major surprise.
But it's still Kerry onto the attack. Billy O'Shea from Lawn Rangers takes the point after just 1 minute and 26 seconds of play. Kerry open their account. Drops it in low to Martin Flynn. Getting it in for Spencer McInerney. Trying to get inside, gives it back to Flynn. Opportunity, that's a penalty! The hills of Clare will come alive if he bangs this one past O'Leary. It's saved by O'Leary. Well dispossessed by Colin Clancy. Martin Flynn is to his left. Colin Clancy with a point, yes! Clare are on the scoreboard. Giving it back to Joey Kelly. All into space for Tom Morrissey. The poor Clare man, looking at the post. Is that the equaliser? It is! Sean Geaney, Carlo Dwyer in fact it is, giving it outside to Nola Mahoney, and that's a good point for Kerry. Trying to get inside his marker, Stephen Stack, still Flynn, giving it back outside to Noel Roach, in a good position, back to Corey Conway, and the sides are level again. Down towards Noel Roach, Jerry Killeen and Prince McInerney, the break falls for Killeen, good play by the corner forward, ball inside to Prince McInerney, ball on here, he takes his point. Martin Flynn, doing well. Beginning to play a little bit more like the Martin Flynn of Milton Malbay of old. Sending it across. Intelligent ball. Who's corner forward, Corey Conway. Onto the left leg. A point on here. It's going over, and that's a good point for Clare. Clare beginning to play now. The All-Ireland B champions come forward in the shape of a 1-0 Roach in front of the post, and it's a point for Clare. So Maurice Fitzgerald, with one attempt, didn't count, gets his second bite of the cherry, and this time he puts it over. Eamon Breen sending it in. Ball comes to Debrochet, and he sends it wide. The ball cleared. Seamus Clancy underneath it once again. Well, Cora Finn should be proud of his performance. Up go the Kerry men. The break falls down to Tom Morrissey. Gets it inside to Prince McInerney. Back to Colin Clancy. Hello! The Garner County has done it. The kingdom has been rocked to its very foundations. Clare tackling in numbers, still not fouling. Referee allowing advantage. Jack O'Shea in space, and Jack O puts it over the bar. Jerry Killeen, far better position this time, dropping it in. Clancy going up for it, breaks down to Clancy, and it moves to the goal. Another goal for Clare. Kurt Bach beckons for the Banner County. For the first time since 1917, it's the shock of the year. Seamus Moynihan. Parley and Seamus Clancy. Jack O'Shea giving it to Billy O'Shea. To Parley, there's a goal on here. Oh, magnificent save by James Hanrahan. But the danger isn't over yet. Back to Billy O'Shea. An attempt at a point and it's gone over. Back comes Connie Murphy. Great defending by Clare, but he's going straight through, and he puts it over the bar. Jerry Killeen. A point here would ensure victory, perhaps. Killeen on the run, puts it over the bar. As I look at the watch, 34 minutes and 50 seconds gone, as Maurice Fitzgerald takes the break. Trying to drop it in. It's going in, and it's gone over the bar. Gives it outside to Jerry Killeen. Just to put the icing on the cake. Oh, yes! It's a sweet, wonderful cake for the Banner County. Kerry have been beaten in the shock of the year, possibly the shock of the decade. And I can tell you that there won't be a cow milked in County Clare for at least a week.
The Ulster Championship was going to be, as usual, extremely competitive. And of course it had an added bite this year with the reigning All-Ireland champions down, and the newly crowned National League champions Derry competing in it. And indeed, the very first game in the championship threw up the National League finalists, Derry against Tyrone, a match played at Celtic Park. It was a very, very keenly contested game. It came only a fortnight after the National League final, and Derry got off to a great start, and Dermot Heaney scored a tremendous goal.
And now we have a chance, and a brilliant goal, magnificently finished by Dermot Heaney. Well, what a start for Derry. Celtic Park comes alight.
Dermot Heaney had just a couple of moments prior been into the middle looking for a ball for McCusker. Didn't get to it. This time he did, with loads of time, and picks his spot.
The Cavan Donegal game at Breffni Park, in many ways, was possibly the best game in the entire championship because of the amount of free-flowing open football that was played in it.
Tried to hang in the air, it didn't work for him. Stephen King takes the quick free, and here's definitely a chance. Cahill, a loose Gary Walsh, and blasts it into the back of the net. Cahill, one goal and 2 points, but Cavan, one goal and three. Donal Reid, he scored 2 points in the first 5 minutes last year. He'll be looking to inspire his forwards to score a lot more today. McHugh in with a left foot. Boyle was in there. It's in the net, and the goal stands. Well, that is just a shot in the arm that Donegal needed. Up go the big men. Aidan Waters collects it, lobs it in. There's a race. Dean O'Reilly hooks it magnificently over the bar. Martin McHugh. Well, well, well. 50 metres out. Now, Martin McHugh has scored many important points for Donegal over the years. Will he try to score this one? He gets a foot behind it. He launches it in. It's over the bar. The wee man from Kilcar. And towards the full forward line it goes. The break, all important. Vivian Dowd, back it goes. The man who brought the sides level has brought them level again.
Both teams lived to fight another day. And that day came in terrible conditions a week later at Ballybofey.
Picked up again by Tommy Ryan. Cutting his way through, it's still Ryan for Donegal. In a dangerous position. Fisting it across and fisting it over the bar. Now a race for possession. Bernard Morris, the covering cabin player. Nicely knocked down by Barry Cunningham. Still Morris in possession, and that'll be another throw ball. And Philip Smith has been sent off. The cabin team locked as he went to take it towards Stephen King, so that's another 10 metres forward. Now King takes it from the ground into Damien Riley. Has he space at foot to go? Oh, a superb goal by Damien Riley! Donal Reid, Charlie Mulgrew, giving it in now towards young James McHugh. Chance down front to go. Well, I missed one from this area before, not this time though.
The Antrim Fermanagh clash ended with Fermanagh again emerging victorious.
He has plenty of support. Gets inside his marker. Gives it inside to Stephen Mulvenna. This is the substitute going for goal. Oh, yes! A superb goal. Super sub Mulvenna from St. Paul's. A wonderful substitution by Antrim's new manager, PJ O'Hare, bringing in Stephen Mulvenna. But here come Fermanagh. John Rehill giving it inside to Paul Coyle. Trying to get onto the left boot. They're lining up for it, and they've got the goal.
Down, as defending All-Ireland champions faced a very difficult task against Armagh in the athletic grounds. Another packed house, all ticket affair, and Down were mostly in control, but it took a great James McCartan goal. Just 5 minutes before half-time, he collected a long lob from John Kelly, he turned on the sixpence and crashed the ball into the net.
Now got 2 minutes of injury time played in this first half. A long probing ball, a dangerous ball, oh, superbly gathered, oh, what a goal! An absolute peach of a goal, copybook stuff, written and finished by one James McCartan.
Best player in the business to turn and shoot gives Brendan Tierney no chance whatsoever with that from about 10 yards out.
The Monaghan dirty game at Castle Blaney was quite extraordinary because for 60 minutes of the game, Derry were in complete control. And then, literally, in a matter of moments, the game was turned upside down.
And driven into that danger again. McGinnity, printed the head on the chest. Still McGinnity. The chance into the back of the net. And the under 21 star is the man who raises the green flag for Monaghan. And Edwin Murphy kicks a ball in towards McGinnity again. He got it the first time, he's got it again, and off the crossbar, and eventually finished into the back of the net by Ray McCarron. And there's that all-important goal scorer, McCarron. Still McCarron tries to get on the left foot. Is this the equaliser? McGinnity's in. Is he in before the ball? The goal stands, and the goal scorer, the man who started the revival, has got his second and Monaghan's third.
But when it doesn't go the full way, Stephen McGinnity wins the race with Kieran McKeever and gets the touch. Run it in.
At the far end, Cassidy is blocked. A chance! The ball is in the net. Declan Bateson, the only forward who hadn't scored up to this, is the man who gets it in there, and is he the one who has killed off Monaghan.
Unbelievable finish. Confusion in at the Monaghan, in front of the Monaghan goal. David Cassidy was, he lost possession, fumbled there, two poked by a defender, straight to Bateson, and he two pokes it in. Gripping stuff. Here it is again, very coolly finished by Declan Bateson from the edge of the small square. What a finish.
So a game that lay dormant for so long and appeared to have gone out of Monaghan's reach, then it went the other way. And now with just 10 seconds to go. Graham McCarron are fleeing the 45 metre line. He gets the ball across to Jerry Moan. He chips it up, chips it over, and now the sides are level.
Picked up by Tony Scullion. Again the kick into the open space. Cassidy has it. Gives it to Downey. Back to McNichol, and that's a penalty surely. And it's a goal. Gary Coleman. And it looks as if they really do want to go for the ball. Brendan Murray most certainly does. And Gormley wins the race, picks the ball up very well, trying to cut in along the byline. Paying it back towards Bateson. Yes, Declan Bateson gets goal number two for Derry.
That left from Manor pitted against Donegal in the first semi-final. This game was played at Oma, and for quite a while Fermanagh led and played very, very well.
Boyle can hold it. McHugh's inside, or is it James McHugh that is? The chance. Oh, beautifully finished. Donegal captain Malloy switches the play across towards Boyle, and two men collide, and away goes Tommy Ryan, and we've got a two-on-one situation here. Ryan shoots. Oh, what a finish. Perfection.
Casement Park.
This was the semi-final everyone in Ulster wanted. The reigning All-Ireland champions against the National League champions. A packed house at Casement Park, 35,000 people, all ticket. And on the day Down simply could not find the form and the power that had seen them win the All-Ireland in 91.
And Bateson has it. And he takes the first score of the match. Damien McCusker's kick out. Great height, great distance. Comes straight down to Dermot Heaney, giving it inside. This is Anthony Toohill. Shot and a great point. And that was a poor pass by Scullion because Mickey Linden read it well. Gives it back outside to Gary Mason. And that's a great point for Down. Sending it in. This is a good ball. Declan Bateson giving it in to Enda Gormley. And from a very difficult angle, that's a great point by Enda Gormley. Ryan McGilligan driving it down towards Anthony Toll. Oh, great fielding by Toll. Using his height to his full advantage. Giving it outside to Damien Cassidy. Colly Mason after him. Cassidy lobs it and scores over the bar. That is a brilliant score by Derry. Dermot McNichol giving it back to Henry Downey. All alone over this side is Dermot Heaney. Now, will he take his point? Oh, that's a great effort by Dermot Heaney. That's not a high ball which the down forwards normally don't like, but Peter Whitnell giving it inside. Oh, great defending by Dermot Heaney. 1 minute he's up scoring a point, next minute he's preventing what seemed to be a certain score. And the referee wants to have a word with Peter Whitnell, and he's sending off Peter Whitnell. The second booking for the down full forward. This match really shows how important it is to win midfield, because the type of ball that's going into the down forwards leaves a lot to be desired. But when it goes in properly, Mickey Linden has the ability to take the scores. And now there are just 2 points between the sides, despite the fact that Down are trailing in terms of numerical men on the field. 14 to 15 men, 2 points between the sides. Giving it back to Colly Mason. Has the confidence to have a lash. Oh, what a score! Enda Gormley. Is this to ensure victory? Yes, a brilliant 45 by Enda Gormley. Are we about to witness a little bit of history? As the National League champion Seamus Downey showed tremendous character. Giving it across to Cassidy. The former Ballyhale star sends it over the bar. Damien Cassidy from Ballyhale ensures that Down, the All-Ireland champions, are gone.
Donegal were many people's favourites because they said that they had the relatively easier passage into the final. Derry had come through the hard way. Derry had played 4 matches to get to the Ulster final. They had just finished the National League campaign, and certainly they weren't short of match practice.
Martin McHugh with the first scoring chance of the match. A great point, a great kick by Martin McHugh. James McHugh giving a good ball to Donal Reid, an attacking right half-back for Donegal, who has kicked lots of points in a good career, and he has now kicked another beauty.
Knocked over the sideline by Martin Shovlin. Very experienced Donegal defender. Knocked down to Declan Bateson on the run. Play on, says the referee. And well blocked down there by Martin Gavigan. But McNichol picks up the pieces and picks up the point. Kieran McKeever now. Well given by Enda Gormley to Dermot McNichol, who had to slip a high tackle. And the referee, Jim Kern, is going to take out the book for John Cunningham of Killybegs in Donegal. And John Cunningham of Donegal has been sent off by referee Jim Curran. Enda Gormley, even into the wind, will have a real go at that, this one. It suited Enda Gormley. And he got it. That's a lovely kick by the Derry sharpshooter. The hard-working Tommy Ryan, who'll get onto his left again and try for the point. A very good kick by Tommy Ryan. Great marksmanship. Their fourth Ulster final in a row. But now the loose man tells. Gary Coleman. Well taken there by Enda Gormley. Given in to Seamus Downey. There's a goal here for Seamus Downey. And it's come off the post. It can still come, however. Cassidy drives it. Downey drives it. Downey is the man who puts it in. Entertaining stuff. Hard stuff. As Anthony Molloy lifts Donegal. Brian Murray. A good ball by Brian Murray. A great ball by Brian Murray. Gary Coleman, the extra man, playing more forward now. Dropping it into Downey. Holds it well, Downey. Wants to give it to somebody. He has Gormley there. And this is Enda Gormley. The angle suits him. And there's the equalising point for a revitalised Derry. A good shoulder, but it didn't bother Boner. Tommy Ryan gives it to Martin McHugh. There's a point there for Martin McHugh. Yes. Martin McHugh to take it from Donal Reid. To Martin Shovlin up attacking. Back to Martin McHugh. There's a man free in front of the goal. But Martin McHugh goes for his own score from a very tight angle. It was very ambitious, but it was brilliantly executed by Martin McHugh. Donegal, hoping against hope. Gormley chips it, looking for the goal. Knocked down to the full forward, Downey. His kick is blocked. Enda Gormley tries again, almost 2 minutes into injury time. McNichol and McGilligan. But it's won there by Donegal, and it's all over. Donegal have done it.
Donegal back in Croke Park again and trying to break their semi-final duck. And certainly on that day against Mayo, they showed a lot of nerves and indeed a lot of inaccuracy. In the first half, Mayo played very direct and very well organised football.
Not a good clearance, not as far as Finnerty. And he's got the chance to put Mayo in front. So, a chance to increase the lead. It curls in delightfully inside that far post. Nothing untoward really happening anywhere on the field so far. Now, James McHugh. Progress stopped. He picked it up well and he scored a good point. That's a very good one for James McHugh. 45 high up into the air, dropping neatly over the crossbar to tie up the match at 2 points apiece. Still Tony Morley, always good for a point or two. Lobbed across towards the big man, he's got it too. Fed back to Finnerty, looking for another point. Fisted in again by Morley, and Shovlin took up a perfect position right on the goal line. Dramatic stuff down in front of the Donegal goal. And Liam McHale very much causing problems with his height. Namar driving it defiantly over the bar. Sean Marr explaining that he thought it was a fair shoulder. It's taken quickly inside to Brian Murray to complete the movement, and that perhaps Donegal at their best, thinking quickly. So TJ Kilgallen, Mayo's outstanding footballer of modern times, surely.
player who gave an outstanding display in the 88 semi-final against Meath, at the end of which he mysteriously was denied an All-Star. Well, that's life. That's fisted on, and it's stopped brilliantly, somehow, by superb reflexes from Gary Walsh. Once again, it's Kevin Staunton. Nicely fed forward for Raymond Dempsey. With a suited left-footed kicker, but he can kick with both the left and the right. A very special kind of footballer.
So left foot
of Declan Bonner, getting his third point right on the call of half-time to tie up the scores. Donegal 6, Mayo 6. Sean Maher continuing to forage down that right-hand side. Nicely forward from McHale again. The Giants striding forward, nonchalantly kicking, and he puts it over the bar. James McHugh, his side trailing by 2 points. Is it to be another disappointing day for Donegal? Not if James, or not if Martin McHugh has his way. Malice Boyle comes down. Flanagan fisting it away, but only as far as Boyle again. This is a chance. Donegal's first point of the second half, scored by Tony Boyle. Malice Boyle with 2 points since he came in. They needed a very assured kicker. 2 points from three, his tally so far. Now 3 points out of 4 chances. And the gap widens, and it looks particularly good for Donegal. McHale now, down towards Raymond Dempsey. Mayo needing a goal. TJ Kilcullen, is he to be denied of another place in an All-Ireland final? An elbow by Noel Hegarty, giving Mayo the free. Will he be content to tap it over with time remaining? He is. So he narrows it to a mere 2 point difference. Cut out brilliantly by Martin Gavigan. On towards Anthony Molloy, the team captain, crossing the 65 metre line. Down towards Tony Boyle. Boyle trying to sneak inside the cover of Peter Ford. Still Tony Boyle going for a score, and he's put it over the bar. Gavigan belting it into the clear towards Tony Boyle. The goalkeeper's off his line, and Irwin leaving the ball inside, and this is how they can wrap it up. Oh, that's a penalty. Barry Cunningham taken down. A penalty right at the death to seal a Donegal victory.
Again, it was Tony Boyle who did the damage. Passes into Barry Cunningham. Should have stuck the ball away anyway before he was even tackled. Tomás Tierney coming in and takes the ball off his toe, but takes Barry Cunningham as well.
They'll take a point surely here.
Should kick it over the bar.
Very sensibly done by Martin McHugh. Everybody and anybody wants to be part of a very, very famous Donegal victory. And the full-time score reading, Donegal 13 points, Mayo 9, Donegal for the final.
A very historic day this, with Clare back in Croke Park after 75 years, and the colour and the excitement and the obvious joy of the Clare supporters adding enormously to the occasion. Dublin got off to a tremendous start.
Vinnie Murphy gathering it, plenty of Clare players around him, and the free and the first decision is given to Dublin. The cheering is Clare. The score belongs to Dublin. After just 90 seconds of play, Charlie Redmond puts Dublin in front. This is Dave Forn. Once shared a flat with Frankie Griffin for Kinross in Chicago. This is Jack Sheedy. Good scorable position. And that's a very fine point. Fine kick out by James Hanahan. Ed Maloney trying to gather it. Falls out towards Keith Barr. Well gathered by Vinnie Murphy. And that's another good score by Dublin. Colin Clancy in space. Corey Conway's gone inside. The colour Finnman looking for a little bit of support. Trying to get inside Keith Barr. The support comes in the form of Noel Roach. He's on the 20 metre line. And Clare get their frame. They say that good luck is two. If Clare attack is three Magpies. And Clare register their first score. The Dumbeg man trying to get inside Tommy Carr, has the confidence to take on the Dublin captain, giving it to another Magpie, Frank McInerney. Noel Roach from Kiki is outside. Roachy going through to Corey Conway, going for the point, and it's over the bar. Knocked away, attacked by Dublin, knocking it down to their wing forwards and corner forwards. Dizzy Farrell to Vinnie Murphy, and the inside. Oh, what a marvellous goal! Vinnie Murphy,
a peach of a goal that sends his 16 alive. That's the kind of goal that you're going to get in any match. Dublin settling into a rhythm now. Gives it to Paul Clark. Going for a point. And that's a marvellous score. Francis showing some nice skill. Getting inside Jerry Hargan. Going for the point. And he sends it over the bar. The man from Finglas going for place in the All-Ireland final. And put his team further in front. Ball falls behind Tommy Carr. Corey Conway. He's showing well in this match. Trying to get inside. The Ballymun Kickers man still. Corey Conway. That's a good score. It's Charlie Redmond from Dublin that sends it up. A good ball to Jack Sheedy. Outside of his Paul Curran. Great attacking halfback. Dropping it in. Oh, that's a superb point. And Clare have a point on the scoreboard. Jack Sheedy again aiming at Vinnie Murphy. Comes back outside to Niall Iden, and that's a good score for Dublin. Trying to open it up towards Martin Flynn. Giving it inside to McInerney again. Back to Flynn. Playing it a little bit too tight. Francis driving it in. Sending it over the crossbar. The break falls to Paul Clark. Two Clare players still on the deck. Charlie Redmond going through. Forced his way forward. Good position. And a good point by Charlie Redmond. Heath Barr outside the Clare 45. Takes this free. Dangerously in. Falls from Des Farrell. Back to Jack Sheedy. Takes his points splendidly. Great falls for Jerry Killeen. Back to his right is Corey Conway. And Conway has it. To his left is Colin Clancy. Can he get the right boot to it? He's looking for a penalty and he's got it. This is unquestionably the most important kick in Jerry Killeen's life. It keeps Clare possibly in the All-Ireland semi-final. Dunbegman taking on O'Dwyer. Saved. But he has it, it's there! The referee has blown his whistle and it's... Yes, it's there! Keith Barr. Driving it in, and a goal for Dublin! An amazing turnaround in this game. He needs a little bit of help. That's great tackling and tenacity by Dublin. Jack Sheedy. They have the overlap here. Comes to Paul Beelan. Inside is Mick Galvin. He must score. He does. Surely now, Dublin have wrapped up this All-Ireland semi-final. Michael Rohan nipping in. Giving it to Frankie Griffin. Still Clare come forward. Run through is Noel Roach and a good run. You need a goal here. Corey Conway. Can he get it in? It's there. A goal for Clare. To Colin Clancy. Been a revelation on this Clare team. To Michael Rohan, going for a point. It's Taylor that's gone over the bar. The wee man from Kilmurry, I reckon, puts it just 4 points between the sides. Michael Rohan knocking it down. Comes to Charlie Redmond, to Jesse Farrell. A point here just to make sure. And that's exactly what he's got. Jesse Farrell ensures that it is a Dublin Donegal All-Ireland final. The final score on All-Ireland semi-final day on Clare's first performance since 1917, that's the full-time score. Dublin, 3 goals and 14 points. Clare, 2 goals and 12.
Naturally enough, as a player, I would like to have actually led the team onto Croke Park, but as a manager, I suppose, it's the next best thing. And with the set of boys I have, and which I just feel like a father to them, it's going to be a very, very special day for us all here.
It's an amateur sport, but still lots of pressure.
It's an amateur sport, but I can tell you, as a man that would have played some soccer to League of Ireland standards, I would say that it's very professionally run, because it has to be professionally run. We have given it some nights, 4 nights a week, and not to talk about weekend sessions, so maybe to those people outside that don't totally appreciate what's involved, it is a very professionally run organisation.
Bran, it's just a dream come true for you, isn't it?
Yes, I suppose it's like what one would call Roy of the Rover stuff, and it's something I've dreamt about since I was a small boy, and on Sunday it will be the culmination of that.
You're very confident you can win too.
We're very, very confident that we have a side that can go the whole way. We're a very good footballing side. We play a good running game, and Dublin will have to cope with that on Sunday.
Magnificent voice he possesses, and the massed crowds here in support of Donegal and Dublin, the big D's. So the climax of the footballing year, the 104th All-Ireland football final, just now moments away. Will it be Donegal's first or Dublin's 22nd title?
That's a great occasion for our county, and it's something we all dreamed of, and it's happened, and we're going to enjoy it no matter what.
Absolute perfect conditions for a game now. The wind has died and the sun has come in.
So off we go then. And straight away it's Anthony Molloy, the Donegal team captain, kicking it into space. Tony Boyle having to cover it, wrestled to the ground smartly by Gerry Hargan. But smartly is all very well. It was a deliberate foul. So a free to Donegal. And a chance straight away for Martin McHugh just to test the free kicking skills. There were frees missed in the early stages of the semi-final that you felt they'd kick over in their sleep almost. So here's the first attempt, dropping to the right. The first miss of the day. Charlie always takes seven steps back, three steps to the left, and then he'll move again. Four into a circular movement, and after all those steps, he taps it over the bar. And there's the first score after 2.5 minutes. Towards McGaldon. Barry McGowan in there challenge, but he's left it behind to Niall Guidon. Players calling for just inside, but Guidon put the head down. Now he's picked it up and inside towards Galvin. Simple, effective, and he's put it over the bar. Bonner aimed inside towards McMullen in there challenging, comes down here, and it's hit them off the post from James McHugh. Martin McHugh fires it over the bar. It was the very least that attack deserved. Martin McHugh then opens Donegal's scoring account. And Keith Barr, as usual, to wallop it back into the opposition half of the field as they challenge for it. Scrambles loose, won by Desi Farrell. And it's gone outside, but the referee says it's a push and it's a penalty. The referee awards a penalty after 8 minutes of the first half for some pushing on Farrell as he was trying to hit that one in. He hit it wide, but he was pushed in the process.
Again, high ball in here, causing problems for the Donegal defence. Three or four players had a chance of getting it clear before it breaks down to Desi Farrell. And now it's harmless enough. penalty, I think.
I have to say, looking at that again, there didn't seem to be any push. That looked a very harsh decision. Charlie Redmond kicking, and he's put it wide. And I can only think that perhaps it's poetic justice. Paddy won't agree, but I think that was a fairly innocuous challenge, and I doubt very much if the penalty should have been granted. Sheedy gathering towards Vinnie Murphy. It's looking good for Vinnie Murphy against Matt Gallagher. Ominous for Donegal in these early minutes of this match, and that's gone over the bar. Now Donal Reid has intimated that he plans to retire from senior football after this final. That's in towards Manus Boyle. Jersey tug, fed inside nicely. James McHugh. And that's sailed over the bar. A nice point by James McHugh, his first of the match.
Donegal trying to counteract Keith Barr's freeze into Vinnie Murphy by dropping Anthony Molloy back in front of him.
It hasn't worked this time either. He's won three balls now in succession. But they group well, the Donegal backs. But still, Sheedy's available to take the pass. And it's simplicity itself, but so effective. Keith Barr has been very busy watching now, however, as Clark is going to kick this one from the hands. Flick down, and it's Martin Gavigan, known to legions of Donegal fans as Rambo. Bounce judged brilliantly by Bonner. In towards Anthony Molloy, fist forward superbly to Tony Boyle, unmarked momentarily, now going by Hargan, and a chance here to Manus Boyle. Oh, and somehow he's put it up and over the bar, with the goal absolutely yawning in front of him. He's leveled the match, but that it should have been a second Donegal goal, no question about it.
Again, brilliant play by Donegal to get the ball in, and Gerry Hargan had lost Tony Boyle completely. Could have had a shot himself and give it to Manus Boyle, and clips the top of the crossbar and over. Donegal could have two goals at this stage.
Well, Dublin, as we said earlier, inclined to lose concentration from time to time, and that was one instance. This is Jack Sheedy against Martin McHugh. Good work to come back, makes the kick difficult for Jack Sheedy, who watches, and the umpire gives the positive salute, but it's gone over the bar. 2 points for Jack Sheedy, and Dublin respond instantly. Donegal behind by just a point, by 5 points to four, coming looking for an equalising score. Martin McHugh, one of the cleverest footballers in the country. Still Martin McHugh drawing four Dublin defenders to him, and he slots it over the bar for the equaliser. 2 points for Martin McHugh, 5 points apiece, and the game is now turning out to be all we had hoped it might be.
Game going at breakneck speed, and Martin McHugh breaking through and doing what Donegal weren't doing in the semi-final, going straight for the goals and kicking a great point.
While all this is happening, Donegal are back in the attack again. Some great shouldering back in defence. Martin Gavigan was part of the action, and Declan Bonner puts it over the bar. And for the first time in the match, Donegal hit the front. And Paul Curran is standing about 13 metres back, and it's kicked beautifully over the bar by Manus Boyle. Manus Boyle feeding it back here. Tony Boyle to Manus, I should say. Now Tony once again. He's kicked it well, and he's kicked it truly, and he's put it over the bar. Eamon Heary nipping in here, delivering the ammunition inside towards Desi Farrell. Got there well, and he's kicked it over the bar. 3.5 minutes now to go to half-time. Donegal's 19th free. In towards Manus Boyle, fetched well, turning nicely on his right-hand side. And effortlessly put over the bar. Manus Boyle from Killybegs kicks his third point. This could turn out to be a handy little dance craze eventually. Same result. Over the head of Dave Foran, picked up here by James McHugh. Nicely inside to Martin McHugh. They dovetail very nicely indeed, wanting to make an impact in this Donegal's first final, and what an impact they're making. In by Curran, won smartly however by Anthony Molloy, the Donegal team captain. That's going to be the end of the first half. Tommy Sugro's whistle, not heard by too many people. A rip-roaring first half.
Dublin led, and led very comprehensively for a long time, but the Donegal team, cheered on by their legions of fans, have made a huge battle out of this. In a frantic pace, it's Donegal a lead by 3 points. Half-time score, Donegal 10 points, Dublin 7.
All-time, still 35 minutes to play, Adrian. What do you think of the first half?
Good, but we have still to do the same again.
Gary Walsh in his 20th championship match. Now Guyden in towards Vinnie Murphy. A chase in there with Matt Gallagher. Needing to be disciplined. Nicely across the face of the goal, outside for the corner forward, and Mick Galvin obliges. And it's Manus Boyle who comes out to take this one. Tagging on another score. So 9 minutes into the second half, fresh man in midfield, the ball has been put over the bar. Dublin with a huge task to face as Barry Cunningham goes through, taken down by Paul Curran. And as usual, it will be Manus Boyle, the net maker for the fishing industry from Killybegs. And I'm sure if they go on to win this final, the headline writers tomorrow will have great fun as they bid to land the biggest catch in football, the Sam Maguire Cup, and he kicks over a sixth point. Charlie Mulgrew there, among the substitutes there, one of the more experienced players available to the manager. He should be called into action, Niall Guyden. And Niall Guyden pops it over the bar, a point that Dublin very, very badly needs. Bonner. Curries in well, it's another good kick, two from two for Declan Bonner. Turning it outside to Guyden. Rounding Donal Reid. Still now Guyden. Now Jack Sheedy. Well, that's the moment when they needed that attack to produce a score. On the hand, causing a problem or two. Martin Gavigan coming to kick this one. 12 minutes remaining. Donegal 14 points. Dublin 9. And Tony Boyle, challenged by Paul Clark, comes back here again. Still advancing, Manus Boyle. Manus looks to put this one on its way, and it's over the bar. Is that the kind of point that will now ensure Donegal's first All-Ireland final success? Every bit of his own. Paul Clark kicks, and Paul Clark has scored. It's one back, the margin is back to 5 points. Jack Sheedy. Tommy Carr has gone forward for once, the Dublin captain, outside towards Vinnie Murphy, has a scoring chance here. Vinnie Murphy going through, and he's put it over the bar. It's won by Dublin, however. Paul Clark trying to open up the play across here with young Niall Guyden. Guyden against Donal Reid. Oh, into space neatly for Heary to come on to. Usually scores a point. And that's his regular point in the championship for the afternoon. Huge leap in the air by James McHugh, but it's won back there by Donegal's Barry Cunningham. Fed nicely forward. Tony Boyle going through. We haven't had a goal in the match so far. Was there a foul there by Mick Deegan? The referee says yes. Free in, and the free kick of course will be left to Manus Boyle to take. He's hit over 7 points so far, 4 out of 4 from frees, so can he maintain his 100% record? The answer, a very definite yes. Gary Walsh kicking it out. One back there by Barry Cunningham, left-footed forward towards Manus Boyle. Can they kill it off here with a goal? They're satisfied with a point. Well, he's happy to just put that further bit of distance between the sides.
Great ball in from Barry Cunningham to Manus Boyle in behind, and even though he could see John O'Leary, he does the right thing.
It's a bit like witnessing the Undertaker's coming in. It's Paul Clark kicking, and he's put it high and over the bar. Joyce McMullen. Is this to be it for Donegal? It would be a victory that would give a great deal of heart to so many counties around the country. Bonner has put it over. 4 points for Declan Bonner. And Donegal look to be on their way to their very first championship victory. Donegal poised. Well, who would have thought it at the start of the championship? Yes, you'd fancy them to do well in Ulster, but to go the whole way. Well, there were people who said only the traditional winning counties, the Kerrys, the Meads, the Corks and so on, were likely to win, and Dublin as well. Martin McHugh there, anxious for the full-time whistle, and it's over! And Donegal has won the All-Ireland final! They win by 4 points! A tremendous contribution by Manus Boyle with 9, Declan Bonner with 4, the man directing operations, Martin McHugh, got 3, the team captain Anthony Molloy gave a stirring performance in midfield, their backs were quite superb, and it's a win that will thrill Gaelic fans, I'm sure, throughout the country. No disrespect to Dublin, but this will do a lot for Gaelic football. It will do a lot for the so-called weaker counties in a year where Clare emerged from Munster. Donegal came from Ulster, but the difference is they went the whole way. They believed they could do it, and Anthony Molloy, the team captain, inspired by Brian McInniff. What a day for Brian, no doubt about it. They deserve their win. Donal Reid, who said this would be his last day. What a way to bow out if he is indeed to retire from the game. Although I'm sure Brian McInniff and others will have things to say to him maybe afterwards and during the winter, and hope that he comes back again next year. But Anthony Molloy, who retired, who came back, and Gary Walsh, who missed last week's Down County final because of his involvement in this All-Ireland final, well, the wait has been worthwhile. A thrilling win. Anthony Harkin in there as well.
The hern.
And here's the presentation ceremony.
Out from the hern. August Mahoriha. O'Connolly. Either Harshalia is a Walia. The star Cliha Oven in you. Cliha Brass Mortal. Dimmer Fuerna Cli Gomai. Up Dimmer Fuern Tirconnell Nisfar. Gone Po Brown Le Fuern Artlea. August Tresliam Munsher Tirconnell. August Akarja. Tá áthas an dóin orm, an cairn a bhronnú don céadúir, ar Captain Tirconnell, ar Anthony Molloy.
History is made. Anthony Molloy, the first Donegal man to lift Sam. The All-Ireland final is won by Donegal.
I think we're under a lot less pressure coming down here today. You know, I think against Mayo, there was a lot of pressure on us to win. I don't think like that kind of pressure is on us out there today. The lads are out. I think we played our usual football. We mixed it a bit, some long balls, but I think, and some short ones, but I think it was just through Donegal football we saw out there today.
It hasn't sunk in yet. It was great for the people of Donegal. It's great for the people back at home. It's great for the people of Ulster. This is the first time we put back-to-back. Ulster football is on the map.
Well, we had a great thing within the team. You know, we had confidence. Even in Ulster final when we were, you know, not looking too good, we said to ourselves at halftime we could still win it, and we always knew it, you know. We didn't say it too many times, but we always had that feeling. And the same thing was there today.
It's an unreal feeling. It's something that I've said for a lot of years and dreams about. But the feeling one couldn't really describe, because it's an inner warmth. And the fact that Donegal is such a remote county makes it all the more, all the more special to you, because I have a great grasp of my own county and such, you know. As you could see from the receptions we've received over the past couple of days, it's just an unreal situation.
Even before this triumph, you had plenty of success as a player and a manager, but there were dark times too.
You must be glad that you kept bouncing back every time.
Yeah, there were some days one felt like quitting, you know. I can think of National League matches, Championship matches, all I have to do is go back to the Ulster final, or even last spring when Dublin beat us in the quarter final. But this present squad, there was always that feeling that somewhere, somehow, sometime, that we were just going to do it. And I felt that when I went back as manager some 3 years ago. I told the county board then I felt there was an All-Ireland in the side. And me, the Pipters, 2 years ago, we disappointed in the Ulster final last year, but we got the bit between our teeth after the Dublin defeat, and we took it from there. And please go.